Implementing technology is a great way to achieve repeatable and scalable results. Today we're going to be talking about a process of choosing technology and using a process to filter down to the right systems for your company. All right, so our video today will start with a high-level end-to-end process that you can leverage. We'll dive into the preparation and planning before you actually begin, how to research and gain awareness of different vendors out there, the sales and technology evaluation itself, and finish up with the final selection and what next steps could look like. I believe it's always good to have a roadmap and expectations of where you're going. This can be summarized in a kickoff meeting and really align the team on what needs to get done and in what time frame. Here is an outline of what the vendor selection process can look like. Across the top, we have the critical sections of the process in chronological order, and below we have the main activities and deliverables for each area. There's prep work to assemble the team, determine a timeline, and set expectations. The main deliverable out of all of this is the needs analysis that will really help guide the evaluation later. From there, we'll begin researching different vendors. The main deliverables out of this section is the short list of vendors that will proceed to demos and evaluation. Next, we actually engage the sales teams and do a deeper evaluation of the technology and capabilities. It's here that we filter again to our final shortlist for selection. Finally, we finalize the evaluation, make our selection, and move on to contracting and prepping for implementation. This process is in your toolkit, and depending on the size and scope of your project, you can add or eliminate activities and deliverables based on what you think you need for your team. To get started, let's talk through the setup items under preparation. Here is a sample timeline that you can use that aligns with the vendor selection process we just talked about. In the template, you can slide these milestone markers around based on what you think is appropriate for your team. Generally speaking, you can allocate 1 week to kick off the project and finish the prep activities, including the needs analysis that we'll talk about in more detail in a second. From there, maybe 1 to 2 weeks to conduct research. I'd say you can probably get this done in less than a week if you're fully dedicated to the project. But I'm sure you have a lot of other things going on your plate. I'd give 3 to 4 weeks for demos and a deeper evaluation of vendors. You'll likely need more team members involved at this point, and working out schedules across your company and the vendors will tend to spread this time frame out more. Once you have your shortlist, I'd give 1 to 2 weeks to finalize your selection. This gives you time to circle back with vendors on some final questions and iron out any potential contracting or pricing items. Once you've communicated the decision, I'd give 1 to 2 weeks to finalize contracts and start implementation planning. Again, this is just a template that's based on my experience with small and mid-sized companies. In larger corporations, they usually run through a formal RFP process with evaluations that will extend into many more months. One way to define the team and make sure everyone's on the same page of when they're getting involved and what they're doing is using a project RACI. If you need more information, we have another video that explains this concept in more detail that you can check out. But for the most part, you should have a project lead, that's usually the people ops or business lead, someone that understands the operational processes really well. Depending on how big your company is, it'll make sense to have a partner IT lead. From there, it's who you think you'll need from a project support perspective, and the key stakeholders you'll need to consult and keep informed throughout the process. Again, depending on your organizational structure, you may need to formally assign someone from leadership that will be ultimately accountable for this project. They are likely the ones that will own the decision and sign the contract. Now, I've heard too often that people rush into purchasing technology without doing the right legwork up front. They think just implementing technology will solve their problems. But if you automate a bad process, at best, you have a bad process that's faster. What usually happens is that the automation exacerbates other issues that makes the whole system worse. So to avoid this, I'd recommend taking the time to outline your current state process and conducting a high-level needs analysis as part of the preparation. Here's a sample of what it could look like. We're using a specific example here for talent acquisition. Similar structure here with the high-level areas of the talent acquisition process over the top, with the primary owner and then the process flow outlined below. This is more of a completed example, but I'd recommend getting the right stakeholders in a room and whiteboarding the whole process. This will help engage your team and get more perspectives on the next part, which is the pain points and needs you'll try to identify for each area. So, outline the process end to end, make sure you have the right stakeholders in the room, even engage them in the outline of the process, and then go step by step through the current state and discuss what are the pain points and what can be done to improve the current process. You may even find that going through this exercise, you're not at a point where you need that technology. With just some organizational improvements and better communication, you can achieve what you need and resolve a lot of your pain points. Now, if you decide to continue, you now have a solid understanding of what you're looking for in a potential system and a foundation to guide your research and evaluation. Finally, in the preparation, it's good to have an understanding of your budget. This will help eliminate a lot of your vendor choices in the research phase. I'd set up time with your CFO or whoever runs the finances and leadership, and just have a discussion around potential budget allocation. This template can be a facilitation tool for that meeting, so you can see how money is spent today on internal operations and have some questions to help set some budget parameters. As you can see, there are valuable things you can do before you even get started, and that will really help you out down the road. With the preparation done, we can move into how to conduct research on vendors and how to organize the information you find. One way to visualize the remaining phases of this process is using the idea of a sales funnel. The research phase is entering the top part of the funnel where you're trying to gain awareness on what's out there and start narrowing down to vendors of interest. In the research phase, we can target 10 to 15 vendors for top-level research and then narrow down to about 5 to 10 vendors that will progress into the evaluation stage. From there, we'll engage their sales teams, conduct the demos, and hopefully narrow that down to 2 to 3 vendors where we can do some extensive testing in their trial run systems and then make our selection and purchase. These counts are just suggestions. You can always add or remove more based on how the process is going for you. There are a lot of vendors out there. It can be overwhelming to even know where to start. Here are some pointers just to get you started at the top of that funnel. Referrals are always the best place to start. Hopefully you have a network you can tap into of other professionals in people ops or HR that have experience with some of these technologies. If not, go out and join a network. There are free groups in Facebook and LinkedIn. You can also join a professional society like SHRM or HRCI, and they have forums and resources that will get you started on what's out there. I would check out some comparison websites. G2 is a really good one that categorizes systems really well, and they compile a lot of that top-level information on these vendors. You can also go out and see what companies you admire are using. In our talent acquisition example, you can visit their career pages. If they're using a vendor for this function, you may be able to see that vendor name at the bottom of their job postings. Of course, just a simple Google or YouTube search will also provide some insights on companies you may not have been aware of. As you begin your research, you'll want a way to keep track of what you're finding and remembering why you're moving one vendor forward and eliminating another. We have a template in our toolkit that documents these items that starts with these 4 categories: company info, pricing, fit and reputation, and product features. Based on your approach, these can be just discussion points you use with your team as you share your research. It's a way to help track your findings and filter down vendors with the same criteria across your team. This template is in Excel that we'll share shortly, but we'll use these slides to explain the components. So, just walking through these sections individually, the purple is going to be the explainer on the template, and we'll add 2 sample companies in gray so you can see the info and how it looks side by side with another vendor. Note, these samples that we're using are completely fictional. Starting at the top, the year founded gives insight into how established the company may be. You may be more comfortable with a company that's been around for a while versus a brand new startup. Location may be something you're interested in. Sometimes support onshore or offshore is a factor. The rest of this information is really just meant to give you an idea of the size of the company. You may decide to eliminate a vendor because it's just a startup with a couple clients, or maybe you want to support them because they're a local business in your area. Moving to pricing. This is likely the item that will eliminate a lot of vendors for you, especially if you're a small business. Here we have info on how pricing is calculated, a monthly estimate, you can make this annual if it makes more sense for you, and potential implementation and support costs. If pricing isn't transparent, in my experience, these are likely enterprise software companies, and I wouldn't spend too much time on them if you're a small business. If you are curious, sometimes a search in Quora or other online forums, you'll be able to find pricing that's shared by other people using the system. This next section is focused on company fit and their general reputation. And you can either score or turn these responses into more of a heat map to visualize how these companies stack up against each other. The first question is where you can track and document if anyone has recommended the vendor. The next three questions are around company fit. And the last two are around how they score on review sites like G2, and a quick check on any news that may influence your decision. Again, these templates are to get you started, and you can use or eliminate any of these evaluation criteria if it doesn't make sense for you. Finally, the last item in the research phase is validating their product features. Just based on their website and the online research you've conducted, do they have the core functionality of what you've identified in your needs analysis? Here, you can also add additional comments on any features that stand out and your general take on the product's user interface. Finally, if you're presenting to leadership after this phase, we've included some PowerPoint templates that you can use to summarize the information on the shortlist that will move into the evaluation phase. We have one that reflects the comparison tracker and one that focuses on individual vendors if you want to share more detailed information. All right. At this point, you've leveraged the comparison tracker and narrowed down your vendors to about 3 to 5 companies. It's time to engage their salespeople. We've waited until this point after narrowing down a little, because once you reach out to a salesperson, you're in their funnel and they can be quite persistent and will call and email you consistently. When you outreach, you'll likely be sending a message via their website to schedule a demo. It's good to set expectations either in this initial message or a follow-up once the sales rep reaches out to you. But here's generally what they'll be asking and what you can supply to help your demo be as helpful and informative as possible. Start with a summary of your company. Include general information around size, industry, and what you do. Briefly describe why you're looking at their product with any specific features you'd like to see in the demo. Finally, you can give a heads up on any clarification you're looking for based on your research. This could be a concerning review you found or functionality that wasn't fully addressed on their website. Good sales reps will make sure these are priorities in the demo. If they ignore your requests or don't address them, that'll just be another evaluation point in your decision. We'll continue to leverage the tracker to document our experience and evaluation throughout this phase. This is where you can customize the template to all the features and functionality that you want to evaluate. Again, these should be based on what you prioritized from your needs analysis in the preparation phase. Now, I'll say this for demos. Companies approach it in very different ways. For example, some high-growth startups view it as a numbers game. You'll get a demo person that is clearly running through a script, and their knowledge outside that script is very limited. Their goal is volume, and they're incentivized to run through as many demos as they can every day. On the other side, you may have your demo with a true product expert, an engineer, or even a founder that knows the product deeply and will take the time to answer as many of your questions as they can on the spot. Either way, the whole sales process should be part of your evaluation, and we have a section for that as well in the tracker. Here you can rate the overall experience from the organization, communication, and the sales team, from the lead to any subject matter experts that you engage throughout the process. You can always add comments at each stage and update this section as you move along the sales process. After you had the initial demo and maybe some follow-ups, I'd request access to a trial version if that's not already available. It's good for your team to go into the system and test it out to identify any nuances of their design and functionality. You can use the trial run section of the tracker to document the evaluation. I'd come up with a couple use cases that each evaluator on your team will try to replicate in the system. They can each document in their own tracker and then come back to the team and compare notes. This is where you can also go back to your needs analysis and leverage that current state process flow to see if you can replicate parts or the whole process end to end in the system. In this example, you can have different team members play the role of candidate, hiring manager, and interviewer to see how the system functions for each role. At this point, you'll have to make a final selection. Hopefully you've narrowed down to your last 2 vendors and you can do any additional follow-ups and bring in finance or legal if you have any concerns around contracting or their pricing mechanisms. Vendors may even try to sweeten the deal and have you sign a longer-term contract for discounts. At this point, you've reached the end of this vendor selection project, and you'll begin the transition to implementation. You'll likely engage a specialist from the vendor that will lead you through the implementation, but similar to this project, you'll need to formulate a team from your company, and you'll start working through items like planning, coordinating timelines and milestones with the vendor, design, learning the system and determining what the future state looks like with the new technology, configuration. Either you or the vendor will actually go into the system and set it up based on your design decisions. Communications across your company and training they'll need. And finally, go live prep, making sure everything is in place and you have a support system for the initial launch of the new system. That's our tutorial on vendor selection. All our slides and templates are available for download in our toolkit. These are a big time saver and designed so you can hit the ground running immediately on your project. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.